Now, it was the verdict, 40 years in the making.
Christopher Michael Dawson on the charge that on or about 8 January 1982 at Bayview or elsewhere in the state of New South Wales, you did murder Lynette Dawson. I find you guilty.
Supreme Court Judge Ian Harrison determined yesterday that former school teacher Chris Dawson murdered his first wife, Lynette, and disposed of her body so that he could have an unfettered relationship with his former student and teenage babysitter. Now, the story captured the world's attention thanks to the hit podcast and by the Australian newspaper's National Chief Correspondent, Hedley Thomas, who joins us now. Hedley, thank you for being with us. Wow, this must feel like vindication for you.
Look, I feel so glad for Lynn's family. Her brother Greg and sister Pat Jenkins and all of their relations and Lynn's friends on the Northern Beaches who never gave up hope. This is something they've been waiting for so long, and they've been knocked back over many years by prosecutors who said, no, we're not taking this to trial. The police were frustrated beyond what you could imagine. They said, we have enough evidence. There is his lies. There are all of these accounts of this extraordinary connection that Chris Dawson had to a schoolgirl half his age, a girl he wanted to spend the rest of his life with, and yet no prosecution. And finally, as a result of the Unsolved Homicide Squad investigation, I think the focus that was applied by the podcast The Teacher's Pet, new witnesses and evidence, Chris Dawson was finally charged, and here we are 4.5 years later.
Yeah. Guilty verdicts in cases with no body are very, very hard to get. How confident were you that the judge would find Dawson guilty?
Tristan, I wasn't overwhelmingly confident because there have been so many setbacks and disappointments in this case. It was almost like it was jinxed to never see Chris Dawson face up to what he undoubtedly did. But I did believe that he was more likely than not to be convicted. I know a lot of people were disagreeing with that outcome in that they thought that was the right outcome. They just didn't believe it would be reached. And that was the feedback I got from a lot of friends, a number of lawyers, and people who had followed the case closely. But I thought the judge got it. You know, I was watching closely during the latter stages of the murder trial, hearing the judge's questions, working out, as he did so carefully, what the lies were. And it seemed plain then that the judge had realised that there had been incredible deception practised here from the very start, a deception that was obvious, or should have been obvious, in the beginning to police in the 1980s. And to prosecutors afterwards, but it took a long time. Chris Dawson's had 40 years of freedom.
And it's also a huge thanks to your dogged determination that that this cold case was given new life. You said that you became obsessed by this story, Hedley. What was the fascination for you? What started things for you with this story?
You know, once in a career, perhaps, you come across a case that is just so profoundly unjust and in many ways cruel. The cruelty was not just to Lynn Dawson's siblings and her parents, who were told that their daughter had just taken off and not bothered to get in touch again, only contact Chris. More cruel, from where I stood back in 2001 when I first reported on this case, was the lie that was perpetrated by Chris Dawson and his side of the family to Lynn's two daughters. These were two little girls that Lynn believed she would never be able to have. She had trouble conceiving for years. She had surgery so that she could have children. She was absolutely besotted with her daughters. And the lie that she didn't care enough about them, that she would just abandon them as a young mum and go off and live a life without any contact with them ever again, was just absurd, ridiculous, offensive, unfair. And I think that as a young father myself at that time, my own son was a toddler, my wife was heavily pregnant with our little girl, you know, that really did have an impact, and I think was part of the spur that I felt that carried on when I did the podcast series and started investigating that in 2017 and released episodes through 2018 after months of investigation.
I think we'd all felt that way as parents as well. Yeah, the judge obviously determined that Lynn would not have left her two daughters. Her friends and family always maintain that. Have you spoken to her daughters? I mean, do you know how they are or how they're feeling?
Yeah, I've had contact since the podcast, since I started working on the podcast, with Lynn's eldest daughter, Chanel, who's just such a loving mum herself, who wishes, you know, that she had known her own mother, who has understood, I believe, what happened to her mother. And, you know, I'm sure that Chanel, living in northern New South Wales, is reflecting on these events and what's happened with a great sense of remorse and perhaps a sense that justice has been delivered. I think that would be the case. I don't want to speak too much for Chanel. She's such a good person. I haven't had contact with Chris Dawson's youngest daughter, and I don't know what her position is. She may be standing by her father. She may believe that he has been unfairly stitched up. That is, again, a matter for her. That was her view early on. She believed that the babysitter, who had been Chris Dawson's student at Cromer High, who then became his wife and the stepmother to those little girls, she believed that woman, who was such a crucial witness in this trial, was just determined to destroy her dad with lies. The judge said that was untrue, that JC, as we call her, told the truth and was credible, and he accepted her evidence.
Hedley, what has been the impact on the young babysitter who later married Chris Dawson? You said that you interviewed her for the Teacher's Pet podcast. Has this affected her and impacted her life?
Oh, absolutely. I think she has been very severely impacted by what's happened. You know, she was a teenager when she was involved with Chris Dawson, and then his de facto and then his wife, and then a young mother herself. They had a child together. She raised Chris Dawson's daughters to Lynn. You can imagine the burden that she has felt over these years as it dawned on her that her then husband, from whom she separated in 1990, almost certainly killed his first wife to be with her. That would be weighing on her conscience. She's done nothing wrong as a young, very young person at that time.
So many victims in this story.
There really is, yeah. Lynn's brother Greg asked for Dawson to reveal the location of her body. Do you think that he ever will?
I don't think he will, unless there's something held out for him in return. I think it'll be transactional if he does. If he thinks he might get out of prison a little sooner with perhaps early parole, then that might happen. He's 74, so it'll be interesting to see how long he's sentenced for. You know, I think it's timely right now for the New South Wales Premier to look at a no-body, no-parole law, to change the law so that it becomes absolutely mandatory, compulsory, like it is in Queensland. If you've killed someone, been convicted for it, and the remains, the body of that person has not been disclosed, you don't get out of jail unless you tell the authorities where the body is. Even when you're eligible for parole, you stay in the bin until you say, that's it. The Queensland government's got this right in the view of the victims' families, because it gives them some comfort. And, you know, it's time, surely, for the authorities across Australia, but particularly in New South Wales, where they have a nobody, no parole law, but it's optional. It doesn't need to be applied by the parole board. Change that, get rid of it, make it firm, make it stick so that the families get comfort.
Yeah, and so Lynette can rest well, as her brother said yesterday. Hedley Thomas, thank you so much for joining us. We do appreciate your time. We know it's been an incredibly busy 48 hours for you, and well done on a wonderful result.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you, Tristan.
You can find out more about this incredible story at theteacherstrial.com.au. That's following up from the Teachers Pet podcast.